And now I'm extremely delighted to bring to you Jeremy White, the graphics editor of the New York Times, who will be introducing today's speaker.
Hello, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'm one of the graphics editors at the New York Times, and was pretty happy when David asked if I would introduce him, because it gives me an opportunity to talk about maps, which I really enjoy. And my friends and family are sick of hearing me talk about maps, so this is great for me. So at the New York Times, we make a lot of maps. And we have these books around the newsroom from different decades where we created paper maps and clipped them out, put them in these books so we can refer to them later. So I'm going to be talking about a couple of these from the mid to late 1940s. There was quite literally a land grab that was happening in the world. And projections really came into play here when you tried to take the 3D globe and put them on a 2D plane and explain these stories and get these incidents across to the general public. So let's start with the first map in the New York Times. This is a hand-drawn map from 1863. At this scale, we don't have to worry about projections too much, which is good, because it would have been tough to handle back then, especially for this area. So flash forward to the first US map that we could find. There may be some older maps. We really tried to scour what we had in terms of both in our library and in the books that we have, not only in the graphics department, but the rest of the newsroom. So this is a map from 1896, a presidential election map. A few things to note. What's interesting about this is the split Michigan across the title here. So the Upper Peninsula of Michigan has the first few letters. The rest of Michigan has the rest. Flash forward 4 years later, and we've got another Michigan problem, which is that it's one large land mass at this point, although the labels are easier to see. So you'll notice that in the previous example here, it looks like the US has been stretched east to west, and it gets a little more narrow here. This is closer to what we would see today, a conic projection that we would use in some of our mapping software. And 40 years after that, this is definitely closer to what we would see today in terms of a national map. So, and this map, coincidentally, if any of you remember ever seeing that picture of Truman holding up the Chicago Tribune where it says, Dewey beats Truman, that's this election here. It's kind of fun. So in the late 1940s, there was we really had to look at different parts of the world. And when you do a projection, you end up distorting what you're looking at. And so you choose what you'd like to distort the least. So you're either distorting shape or area or distance or direction. So I'll show a few examples here of each where the decision was made to try and preserve one over the other or over the others. So we'll take a look at the poles. So these orthographic view from space projections are very nice for preserving the shape of a single area. And the closer you are to center, the better off you'll be in terms of preserving that shape and also the area associated with it. So North Pole, South Pole, how Antarctica would be divided up. It's kind of fun. Distance became very important. How far could an airplane fly one way, round trip? So you see here you can go to the mid-Atlantic before having to head back, or one way across from the eastern United States across farther east than Moscow. Also, distance from Palestine became a big issue. So these concentric circles were drawn. So you need some sort of equidistant or azimuthal equidistant projection to do these sorts of things. So then if we start to take a look at the globe, a few things happen in the 1940s in terms of the maps from the New York Times. You want to show the world as something that's round. I tell my students that the Earth is an oblate spheroid. It's not exactly round, but it's not as wide as what we see here. And there are some other examples we'll go through. Here, the Earth is a little more round, but Saudi Arabia isn't that large. And there are other continents also here. So you get the idea that this is more of a global view, although we're not seeing the full continents. Here's another example. Things are getting a little better here. Not as wide, but still not, it's kind of unprojected and not bending around the globe as it should. A map of China and what was going on there in the late 40s. Here we see another global view, and actually the land masses on this look really good. We don't have that Mercator-Greenland effect there. You see Greenland near the top. But if we were to put these circles on the surface of the Earth, as the French mathematician Tissot would do when talking about map projections, these wouldn't be circles. They would be skewed and misshapen based on the shape of the Earth. So here's another way of doing this. Take the globe and sort of unwrap it and look at both sides of the Earth. But unfortunately here, we're seeing some of the same problem where it's not really the coastlines, the continents, the land masses aren't really bending to the surface of the planet. It's just that these two globes are set side by side, so you get the impression that it is a global view. Other concerns, the Marshall Plan, where the U.S. gave about $17 billion to Western Europe and other countries to try and stop the spread of communism. So these Moscow views became popular in the Times, and with Moscow in the foreground and all the other destinations in the background. So North is not up here. It's a little disorienting. We did a few of these, and here's another view. We're sort of going out from Moscow to the other countries. The problem with this is you're limited in what you can see, and also it is tough to get your bearings right away. So this final example, you see Moscow as at the top of the map, so North is up, and now you can see the full extent of the Marshall Plan and how all of that played out. Also, an example of from Korea and showing that line of latitude and why it was so important. So in many ways, it's difficult to go through and make a decision on what to preserve in terms of area and shape and distance and direction. And if it is too difficult, what you can do is just make a cartogram. A cartogram doesn't preserve anything. You're basically changing the shape, the relative position, that sort of thing, and just applying these mathematical equations to it. So this was called a mathematical map. We would know it as a cartogram today. The first computer map that we could find that was generated by the New York Times was the mayoral race here in New York. What's interesting to note about this is Giuliani is actually shown in blue. So we've got the colors switched here. It wasn't until the 2000 presidential election, actually, that red became Republican and blue became Democrat. So it's kind of interesting. This is from 1996. And now it's time to introduce David. David Swart has if you haven't checked out his Flickr account or his Ignite talk that he gave a couple years ago, you definitely should. Also, he's got some papers and some presentations for the Bridges conferences. They're really compelling. It's great stuff. And here's David.
Thank you, Jeremy, for that warm introduction. That's really nice to hear all about the different map projections. And that's something my mom here to talk to you about as ways to flatten a sphere. So when I first saw a math encounter online, it was a couple of years ago, two or three now. I really wanted to attend. I thought this is fantastic, something for popular mathematics, and so I made it a point to someday attend a Math Encounters presentation. And so you can imagine how honored I am to attend it in this capacity from this side of the podium. because I get to pick the best topic in the world, which is spherical imagery. So the spherical imagery, what is that? We see lots of images everywhere, on screens, on TV, paper, on the ground, there's text, it's everywhere, but it's all flat. Spherical imagery is the kind of imagery that exists on a sphere. Of course, the most common ancient one would be the globe, the continents of the world. But I'm also here to talk to you about spherical panoramas, which is what got me into the whole spherical thinking. And believe it or not, graphics on soccer balls have a lot to do with spheres, and it's not just this one. We'll see it soon enough. But okay, spherical images. What can you do with it? Just a little teaser as to what's coming up is, you can peel this imagery like an orange and flatten it, and we'll literally do something like that soon enough, into interesting shapes. You can get a little more artistic and pattern it across the entire plane if you want to get fancy. Or maybe take it, print it out, cut it out, tape it together to make a physical representation of that spherical image that you can put on your desk or whatever. Spending a little more time, you can take part in the well-known craft of decoupage, where you glue images onto curves and things. And I actually have an old globe that I borrowed to put one of my favorite panoramas on. Believe it or not, it's very difficult to do decoupage. I'm not the most dexterous person. There's some magic that some people are doing, but I do my best. Okay, so let's review the three that I talked about before we get into having all that fun. The first one I wanted to talk about, Jeremy already kind of warmed you up, is the globe. And what about the globe? It's a nice sphere of continents. Okay, when you've got the globe, an actual globe, a physical one, that's about as perfect of a model, or at least theoretically, a perfect model of our Earth as you're going to get. You actually, when it comes time to flatten it, you have to introduce different types of distortion. Area, orientation, distance, size, all these things get, something has to suffer. So that's where cartography comes in. Cartography's one of the tasks of cartography is to turn this spherical image, this globe, this spherical space, into something flat in order to be useful or pretty or whatever. So that's the task at hand. Cartography has been around longer than even just the Renaissance. These projections, this one has been around since, I think, 100 BC? Not quite sure. I'm going to say yes. And it's the equirectangular projection. Okay, the word projection is something that we use as any mapping from the sphere to the plane. Even though there might not be an actual light through a lens kind of projection happening, mathematically, the term for turning a sphere to the plane is a projection. So when I say projection, I just mean a fancy mapping. Great. And this one is the equirectangular projection. It's very simple. It turns all the lines of longitude into vertical lines, equally spaced, and all the lines of latitude into horizontal lines, equally spaced. So it's very easy to map if you've got a latitude and longitude coordinate to your equirectangular map. You just look up your coordinates and look it up on X and Y. So that's what it would look like. Poor Antarctica here. It gets kind of mangled into a long strip along the bottom of our globe. One of the reasons is because the South Pole, or both poles, actually exist on this map as a long line across the bottom or the top of this map. Okay. Our next, I'm just going to go through some of these projections, say some fun things about them. Our next one is the azimuthal equidistant projection. Now, this is very similar, except that instead of top to bottom, this whole projection is azimuthally spread around a point. So in this case, it's the North Pole, could be the South. But all the lines of latitude are concentric rings, equally spaced again, and all the lines of longitude are equally spaced. What would that look like? Like this. Poor Antarctica. It is worse than before. It's turned inside out. But believe it or not, as strange as that is, I guarantee you've seen this before. And this is the actual projection that is used for the United Nations. Antarctica is not even on this map. They've cut it off. Okay, maybe once it becomes a state and joins the UN. Next projection would be a rectilinear projection, and it's kind of fun to think about. Imagine a little guy with a very powerful flashlight shining a light through the Earth. For some reason, there's a floor nearby. And the image of the Earth is projected onto the floor with that. And so that's where, okay, it's a rectangular flashlight. We'll deal with that. And that's actually, I think, if I'm going to just go out and say it, I think that's why a lot of these things are called projections, because a lot of these ideas where you're taking a line or a flashlight and you're heading through. Another way to think of this, actually, is if that little guy in the middle of the Earth took a camera and just took a rectangular picture. And that's why this is a useful projection, because as far as images from a certain person's point of view, this is the one that you would look like through a camera, a movie camera, TV, computer graphics, things like that. So we'll hang on to that in our mind, that projection. We'll use it. And just one last, this projection here is the stereographic projection. It's azimuthal, which means it's centered around a certain point, again, in this case, a pole. But you'll notice that these lines are not equally spaced. They are small in the center, and they grow outwards. And this is kind of a hint why. This is how you generate the stereographic projection. Not physically, perhaps, but in your mind. And you would take a light bulb, a very strong light bulb, and put it at the North Pole of the Earth and shine that light. There's that floor again. But instead of the light being on the center of the Earth, it's raised to the pole. And this projection extends infinitely along the pole. So we'll crop it early. Okay, now we come to Mercator. Mercator is a projection that a lot of people know about, a lot of people pick on, and it's easy to see why. The Greenland problem is one way people talk about it. It's when you show Greenland, which is an island about the size of Madagascar, except you're showing it about the size of Africa. Okay, so people like to pick on it. How dare we misrepresent area. But I wanted to tell you two things that are nice about it. It's cylindrical. Cylindrical just means north, south is up and down. That seems useful. And east and west is side to side. Okay, it's also conformal. Conformal means all the angles are right. So what that means is a sailor sets his compass to northwest and heads here. And if you draw a 45-degree line, you'll land exactly if you follow your compass. If you follow your compass at northwest, for instance, you'll land exactly where that line on that map lands. So yeah, it's useful for sailors, or at least sailors before the days of radio beacons and GPSs. It's also useful for zoomable interactive maps, because if you don't care about the whole globe, but let's say you just want to zoom in to New York City, it's really good at preserving the shape. Nothing's going to get squeezed in. So, you know, things like Google Maps and stuff. So yes, it has a place in for navigation and a place for in zoomable maps and my heart. But again, we've got Antarctica. Okay, Antarctica is, okay, I'll say it, overrepresented. If Greenland is big, this is bigger. Just like the equirectangular projection, where we had the North Pole across the top and the South Pole across the bottom, actually, this is not the South Pole at the bottom. Actually, the Mercator projection is cropped here. It's cropped early. The South Pole is actually a little farther. Let's have a look. Okay, here we have it. Antarctica's here. Let's just pan down a little. Wow. So you know how Greenland got big. Antarctica's getting even bigger. And we see the aerial photographs of the land features. Let's keep going. How far can we go? This is the South Pole station. This is a science station a few feet away of the actual South Pole. We can keep going. It's not at the South Pole, so we're not there yet. Now we're seeing snowflakes. I actually don't think snowflakes form in that temperature, but that's no fun, so I put snowflakes here. And our last slide is the snowflake at the South Pole with all six arms pointing northward. I could keep going, except, you know, to see molecules and then quarks and then whatever's beyond that. But I think you get the point. You can never get to the South Pole. You'll just continue zooming in, not actually getting there. Yes, there's no South Pole. Actually, there is, just not on that map. OK, so this idea of area was not of area being overrepresented didn't sit well with a lot of people. Perhaps we can keep the idea that it's cylindrical. North is up, south is down, etc. But keep area equal. So area in the real world is represented equally with area on the map. Johann Lambert, who's a very bright fellow, came up with this equal area map. The thing with this is it's necessarily stretched side to side. If you impose those kinds of constraints on it, we necessarily have everything squished or stretched in one way or another. The idea, apparently, of equal things in reality being represented equally on the page didn't make it to his engraver. I think he underrepresented some of the features there. So one of the ideas that I think we're familiar with in 2014 is that you can look at a TV program or something, and the aspect ratio is not the same. So imagine you're watching an old-fashioned, you know, standard definition TV show, and it's stretched to fit your widescreen TV. Things don't look right. That's just a change in aspect ratio. And it happens by accident in this world. And apparently, that idea of stretching out or squishing a rectangle of imagery was notable enough back in the day for all these people to get their own projection named after them. Well, you know, I'm a little bit being a little bit silly. Somebody like Tobler actually decided a square might be suitable for a computer storage, and that was deemed notable enough to say Tobler's world in a square. But I think Perhaps it's not creative enough. For instance, as recently as 2002, we're getting new projections with new. So I thought, why don't we all grab a projection for ourselves before they're all taken? Here's some common ones: letter sizes, TV sizes, and photo sizes, and they're not taken as far as cylindrical equal area projections are. Except I was chatting with a very notable map scholar, cartographer, Marc Monmonier, or however, I hope I got that pronunciation right. But he called dibs on 4-3, so that's taken. All right, but like I said, let's try to be creative with it. I thought, if we're peeling oranges and whatnot, why don't I take an orange peel type shape and render it like that? Okay, great. Or what if I cut it like into slices, maybe not all the way, and render it like that? I thought it would be very, you know, looks like a flower. It's kind of pretty. And that's all I was going for, isn't this pretty? I sent it out to the world and got this kind of response back. I've never used an orange peel projection. That's how I imagined the critique in my head. I don't know people who do. Or it's kind of odd, or it's at best novelty. I think the sentiment here is that it's not a useful thing. And I just want to be clear right now. And also there's a architecture maxim. It's all right to decorate construction, but never to construct decoration. So buildings must always be useful. But I did see this applied to maps. It's like, how dare you decorate with maps? But my brother said, decoration for its own sake, it's called art. And so that's the permission I need to just run with it. I'm not going to claim any utility. If it's fun, then with the kind of stuff we're about to see, then mission accomplished. I'm not alone in trying to be creative. Jack Ben White came up with an idea where if you take the earth and chop it up into tiny little pieces, faces, and then put in lots of, knife cuts in that virtual orange peel and unwrap it, you can come up with some very interesting map projections. He called them myriahedral because it's based on a polyhedron with a myriad number of faces. But my inspiration as far as whimsical map projections is Lloyd Burchill, you can see right there, that's just fancy stuff. So the challenge when I see something like that is, what's he doing? How did he do it? What steps did he take? I don't know. Some I do, some I don't. So, that's map projections. We've gotten a nice primer for that. Now I just wanted to chat a bit about spherical panoramas. Spherical panoramas, it's a visible sphere. Imagine the world around you. If you look around, left, right, back, you can do it. Look around, left, right, but also don't forget to look up and down. This is the entire sphere around your head. Imagine a translucent sphere with imagery that matches your surroundings. That's a spherical, the visible sphere. It's also a spherical panorama. I'll just use those terms. Here's a handful that I took. So I'm regaling you with, you know, my summer vacation photos. The idea of a spherical panorama has predated digital photography, and very clever people such as Dick Termes have played with these ideas. What he's done here is he's painted spheres. He's painted the scenes onto spheres, and he's developed ways to use curved ruler so he can do laws of perspective on it. It's just fascinating. How do you take these spherical panoramas yourself, though? The idea is to take images in all directions. You can take one camera and point it in every direction. And there's actually products that'll help you do it. There's mounts that you can manually point, you know, tripod mounts that you can manually point your camera everywhere. Automatic ones that'll just do it itself, all automated. You can make one for $4 if you're so inclined. Make one yourself. Or if, like me, I'm a little bit, I guess, silly in that I just do it by hand, and then I suffer any sort of alignment errors when I actually shift a little bit, stuff like that. But I make do, and it costs nothing. A different way, which is a little more consumer-friendly, I think these are becoming consumer-friendly or products, is to have several small cameras embedded in one rig. There's six of these small cameras in a 3D printed rig or something. This is used for machine vision applications, for instance. This ball here has lots of different cameras. They're small cameras. And I hear the one way it's triggered is when it reaches an apex. If you're to throw it in the air, once it reaches the top of its throw, it will take the photo up high. And so it's kind of funny because every panorama taken that way has somebody like this underneath it. They don't want to drop their expensive camera. The kind I have, actually, right with me, has two ultra-wide spherical lenses, hemispherical lenses, actually, that get stitched together. And usually, I take an opportunity to give myself a memento. So I'm just going to take a spherical panorama right now. I want, on the count of three, everybody to say cheese. One, two, three.
Cheese.
Awesome. All right. We'll see that later. I'll put it on Flickr or something. All right, so once all those photos are taken in every direction, usually there's a little bit of mathematics, but essentially it's that rectilinear projection I was talking about, the little man taking a photo in the center of the Earth. Well, you can just take it on the surface of the Earth. All those rectilinear images can get mapped onto the sphere, and then you've got your spherical panorama. This is a topic for another day, but it just happens, and the seams are nice, and away we go. Now, remember that one projection where we had the light bulb at the top of the planet, and it was projecting onto a floor on the bottom? We can do that real easy, and a lot of people do, with spherical panoramas. Okay, so we've done that. It's projected on the floor. Let's have a look at what that looks like. It looks like that. These are really popular as far as spherical projections go for showing panoramas. It looks like a little planet. Maybe, you know, the little prince might live on or something like that. Has anybody seen these before? Say on the internet or anything like that? Show of hands. Anybody like them? Awesome. I like them too. Small world. I am not apologizing for that joke. Okay, so I've got my handy model of a spherical panorama right here that I used with the decoupage or whatever. What I want to do now is what happens when I turn the sphere sideways? We'll still put a light bulb on the top. What would the floor look like? It'll look like that. Okay, still kind of looks like a super wide lens image. What? Let's go crazy. What happens if you turn it all the way upside down? Looks like a tube with the sky in the center. I think it looks kind of neat. All right, so we've talked about the Earth. We've talked about spherical panoramas. The third thing I want to talk about is soccer balls. Soccer is, there's a lot of people in Europe and South America who will say, oh, it's football. But the word soccer, we're here in America. So also the word soccer is unambiguous. Everybody knows what you're talking about, even though they'll grumble. So I always just use the word soccer. And it's a British term, too. Anyway, when I say soccer ball, a lot of people say, look like this. I want a picture of a soccer ball. There it is. 12 pentagons, 20 hexagons, just like that. Here's the thing. If you go to the store, let's say 2014, if you go to the store and want to buy a soccer ball, you can't find that. And here's what soccer balls look like today. It's just fantastic. There's graphic designers everywhere trying to outdo each other. It's just awesome with different spherical symmetries and everything. So this is something I wanted, here's some more. I wanted to impart to you today is an idea of soccer ball mathematics. And you can do it anytime you're watching some kids play soccer at the field or when you're at the store or whatever, is you can take part in soccer mathematics. It doesn't need any numbers. And it's really an exploration of spherical symmetry. There's all sorts of, all these things have something unique about them. So the first thing before we get into soccer ball mathematics is to get familiar with polyhedra. Polyhedra are just, you know, those shapes where the faces are flat, the edges are sharp, and the points are pointy. And but what a spherical polyhedra is, this is a spherical cube. It's like you're going in and inflating it like a balloon. We still have points and edges and faces, but they're all sitting on a sphere. The next thing is I want you to be familiar with the platonic solids. These are five special, very symmetric polyhedra. And I'm sure you can find dozens of them in different embodiments in the Museum of Mathematics. So here they are. Let's spherize them. All right. So this is what the spherical versions of those polyhedra look like. You know, a cube still has six shapes, six faces, and whatnot. All right, so that's just a nice background. Now we're ready to take part in soccer ball mathematics. This is a soccer ball that you might be familiar with if you turned on any sort of media in the last summer. I've got a small one right here. So the first thing you want to do is count. What to count? Count the edges or on the panels or the corners or the faces. So I'll just do it for you. There are six of these propeller-shaped panels on this ball. There's eight corners inside those triangles. Okay, so six faces, eight corners. I know what that sounds like. I'll look up my, that's a cube. This is a spherical cube. Except those straight lines aren't straight, but we'll deal with that soon enough. And just to help you out, sometimes you'll count six of something and eight of another. It's because the spherical class that, or sorry, the symmetry class that it is one and the same for the cube and the octahedron. If you change the faces of a cube into vertices, you'll get, and the vertices into faces, you'll get the octahedron, and kind of vice versa. How do you do that? It's a little tricky, but they're related. They're brothers or siblings. The tetrahedron is its own dual. The concept I'm talking about is a dual where the faces become corners and the corners become faces. A tetrahedron is its own dual. It's got four faces and four corners. It kind of becomes itself. And dodecahedron and the icosahedron are the same as well. Sorry, are duals to each other as well. And that's why you might see the standard soccer ball with 12 black pentagons and 20 white hexagons. Okay, so number. So we've counted, and we've kind of assigned them into the class, the sphere, the platonic solid class that they belong to. All right, the next step is to look for reflection lines. So, you know, these are lines where if you were to slice it in half and put a mirror there, you would recover the whole rest of the other half of the ball. So here we've got a ball with icosahedral symmetry. We saw it was related to the 1220 class of symmetry. It turns out there are a few more. Anybody want to guess how many lines of symmetry there are? Shout it out if anybody wants to guess. Is it 20? Is it 12? It's 15. I don't know why. It has nothing to do with the number of faces, obviously. Okay. And we get this nice little network. But okay, that's a thing you can do, is count how many times can I slice this ball? 15. That's a neat thing to learn. What's neat also is that each of these triangles is identical to any one of those other triangles, except for the mirror reflections, of course. But it's almost as if you could put actual mirrors at those angles and get a nice view of the soccer ball if you were to have something. That's why this kind of symmetry is called kaleidoscope symmetry, I think. Okay. That's mirror rotation. What about centers of rotation? These are points on the ball where if I was to draw an axis through, I could rotate it a few times and it would get back to itself. So I've marked out, in the middle of every one of these propeller panels is a point of rotational symmetry, fourfold rotational symmetry. I could turn this ball four times and it would match itself before I got back to the home base, I guess. There's a point of rotational symmetry at this corner here. Threefold. I can turn the whole ball on these triangles and it would match itself three times before it returned home. There's one more style of or type of rotational symmetry. Can anybody find it? It's twofold symmetry. Yeah, the middle of the edge, right there. It's awesome. Okay, for that you get a honest-to-goodness Mercator bookmark. There you go. There you go. Awesome. There's one more kind of symmetry here that. That isn't quite a mirror symmetry or a rotation, and it's called a glide reflection. So imagine this figure here with a bunch of right-handed mitts around one side and left-handed mitts on the other. And you can't get from one right-handed mitt to a left-handed mitt without rotating it and then translating it, without reflecting it and then moving it a little bit. Those are called glide reflections. If you have to do both steps to get from one to the other, that's a glide reflection. I haven't seen any of these in the wild, so you might not have to worry too much about it. But if you ever see one, in the wild I mean in the store, on an actual soccer ball, if you see one, let me know. I mean it. I collect them in my head. It's like, ah, yes, that one's done. Okay, so that's pretty much it for the spherical symmetry types, but we can go further. Sometimes there's a difference between the panel design and the graphic design. This is a case where the graphics have rotational symmetry and whatnot, but they're actually based on a tetrahedron, whereas the panels are based on that classic soccer ball pattern. You can also consider or not consider the color. On this ball here, we've got blue and orange and a green panels. And what would change if you were to say you're not allowed to map blue to green, or if you are? All right, so that's pretty advanced. But for extra credit, while you're sitting there, you can get out your textbook. I've got one. Really? It's called The Symmetry of Things, and it's as comprehensive as it claims to be. And as soon as the soccer ball came out, I went up and looked it up, and I was like, aha, I found you. There it is on page 67. Okay, so we were talking about straight edges, and well, these aren't straight edges. These look like an S. So what they did was they took a spherical cube, and instead of that line, they turned it into this S shape. Great. Let's just have a bit of fun with that. Why just the cube? Let's do that with all the spherical polyhedra we've seen. So they look, yeah, that's what I thought when I first saw it. Ooh. And that's the right reaction. So we've seen this right here as one of these guys. And but there's the others. Now let's go extra crazy. And here's some nice flowers. So that's just the actual soccer ball with our little S-shaped trick. Great. I haven't done anything other than just create that image yet. Okay, so we've gone through the globe, spherical panoramas, and we've used soccer ball symmetry to learn about spherical symmetry and have fun with that. But I want to do something with the spherical imagery, not just learn about it. I want to have a spherical image on my desk. But you can't just go to blacks and say, OK, I want 1 8x10, 6 wallets, and a sphere, please. You could, but they would just look at you funny, and then you have to explain that was just a joke. But you can't. So the answer lies in papercraft, at least one answer. Papercraft is a kind of fun project that people have on the internet. Where they pass around these patterns, like this. You would print them out on regular paper, cut them out, fold them, and then glue the tabs together, you know, slot A into tab B or whatever, tab into slot. I've done one here using that rectilinear projection onto pentagons to create a Jupiter dodecahedron. Earth isn't the only thing with planet that we're limited to. So I've got it tilted here so you can see the big the red eye. What is that? The big red spot, that's what they call it. All right. Origami. Origami is a kind of paper craft where you're allowed to fold it, but you can't cut it. You have to start with a square, and you create whatever you can. I saw this pattern for a really nice origami cube and figured out where those faces came from on the square piece of paper, took the spherical imagery. In this case, it was one of the soccer balls that I liked, and printed it. Went, followed the pattern, and got this nice cubic representation of a spherical image. Okay. Now, you can do more. This is, yeah, you get one. So, this is an octahedron paper craft. I've got one right here. It looks like this. And everybody has one. And we're not going to do this part just today. But you've got a pattern to take home with you, and you can give it a try. And it actually is really easy. Essentially, what you're going to do is you're going to cut out 6 of those squares. Not today, just hang on to them when you go home. When you take out 6 of those squares, you're going to fold it diagonally in one direction and diagonally in the other with the imagery printed on the outside. Now there's a internet link for the assembly instructions, so you don't even have to take notes or anything. All right. And for the people at home, there's a nice QR code, and we'll show you how to get the pattern yourself. Okay, so you folded it diagonally in one direction, folded it diagonally in the other, and then so that the imagery is on the outside, and then you fold it horizontal across and down with the imagery on the inside. And then once you've got that done, it forms what's called a water bomb base, because I guess this is the base of the thing, the base step of creating a water bomb, which is a origami project. But anyway, this is called a water bomb base. It looks like that. Okay, now you've got imagery on it, and there's circles here. Now what you want to do, you've got six of them, is you're going to slide them, the ones with circles, under the corresponding tabs of the ones that don't have circles, so you hide them, all right? The assembly instructions are in there. I'll just cut to the chase. Once you've fussed with it for 5 minutes, and you've got one of these, it locks together, and that's kind of neat. And one of the interesting things I like to do is to put it between my palms. Not do that. All right, one more time. Yep, it twists around. So you can all take that home and have fun with that. Okay, more paper craft. What about this? This is a pentagonal hexacontahedron. Okay, that's a bit of a mouthful. In English, literally in English, it's a polyhedron with faces that are pentagons, five-sided shapes, and there's 60 shapes, 60 of those faces, a 60-faced polyhedron. That's all that there is to it, but it's kind of pretty. There's more properties to this one. And instead of just printing this one out, like the regular paper craft, what I did here was I figured out the imagery for the rectangle of each of those faces that don't quite match the pentagon. There's a bit of a gap here and extra stuff here. I did that for each of the faces, cut them out, and I put in slots so that where the extra tabs went outside of the face, I could slot them together and create something that looks like that. This is a fun project to do because it kind of comes together on its own. This type of sculpture is termed a slide together. It was pioneered by a sculptor named George Hart, but I thought this kind of thing needed imagery printed on it, so I've got one of those. Still sticking with the pentagonal hexacontahedron, that's a mouthful, I thought, okay, instead of the Superman symbol shape here, how about I do hearts? And this would be something that you could do for Earth Day, right? I heart Earth. So that resulted in five of those shapes that slotted together and formed something that looks like that. Thought it was kind of neat. There's no gaps in there. Okay, so that's going from the physical, that's going from flat paper to a physical object. But now I want to talk about going the other way. And this is something you can participate in today. So let's start handing out oranges. Everybody gets one. If there's not enough, please share. I think we've got, that's what your napkins are for. Okay, while you're handling, while everybody's getting an orange, peeling, okay, I'll just keep talking until everybody gets an orange. Peeling the skin off an orange, don't peel it yet. Peeling the skin off an orange is a time-honored tradition with many mathematicians, architects, and whatnot. So the architect who created the symphony, the Sydney Opera House, used orange slices as his inspiration for the shapes here. Dr. Seuss, or this wasn't Dr. Seuss, this is Cat in the Hat, got in and described peeling an orange. And actually, the projection here is the good homolysine projection by a cartographer, but it's more affectionately known as the orange peel projection. So there's peeling an orange is something that anybody can do. And the idea, so what we're going to do today, not yet, is first, this is just like the soccer ball mathematics. Something you can take home in your head, and then it's an activity you can have for the rest of your life. So, for real. So, anytime you're in an orange, step one, try to peel it in one piece. It's not the end of the world if you don't, but try. Step two is be fancy. So, here's some fancy things. Now, a lot of these were done with the help of a knife. We're not going to hand out a lot of knives. That's not going to happen, but please try it yourself. We've got this familiar spiral here, which I saw a lot of, or baseball. And the last thing, if you're really pro, and I've never done it myself yet after trying, but if you can peel an orange and flatten it on the table, when you flatten it on the table, all the orange peel is going to want to spread apart or split or break and push away. And that's because going from a curved surface to a flat surface, all the orange peel is going to want to get away from itself. This is an instance where you can take the orange peel, flatten it on a table, and it actually overlaps itself. It's not mathematically impossible to do it. It's just practically impossible. But I encourage you to try. So, okay, now have at it. Anyone wants to? Now's the time you can, you're sufficiently learned. I want to see lots of fancy orange peels. Another thing you can try is try to peel it thin enough so that when you flatten it onto your clipboard, it's longer than the length of the clipboard. That would be awesome. Good. You can eat the orange, too. That's part of the activity, for sure. All right.
Yes.
There you go. Flatten it on the clipboard. But what I'd encourage you to do in your head is continue to try to find a way to overlap that orange peel. Because until you do, I think you won't be bored. So now that we've had a little bit of fun unwrapping an orange and the different ways that the peel can flatten, I just wanted to take you on a little tour of some of the projects I've done using that very idea. My original motivation for coming up with a program that takes a spherical image and flattens it in ways like this was in order to create really just a globe, something like this. Okay, and in order to do that, I looked at the way commercial globes were created. Using a little bit of programming know-how, I was able to come up with something like that, but I never created a globe for years after, once I had printed that, because I had stumbled on a different kind of way to unwrap the sphere. Not a way to wrap the sphere, not a different way to wrap the sphere, but a method that I can use to play with the ways to unwrap the sphere. And let me tell you about that method. And I'm going to show you using an example of a volleyball. Everybody's familiar with panels of a volleyball, perhaps. If not, it's something that looks like this. My goal was to write a generic kind of program where I can specify something that looks like a volleyball as simply as possible, and for the program to take over and map it to the plane. All right, so the first step of my program, the input, was to draw straight lines on the sphere. These straight lines are going to essentially specify the inside of each of the panels that I want to flatten out on the plane. So we're going to start with a set of lines. There are 18 lines in this case, and corresponding lines on the plane. And I think the analogy that I like to use is that these lines, or dots in some cases, are home base. It's the known world, and we don't know anything about it, the world yet. But we send out explorers, and these explorers are going to head out from the home base and start exploring the way they do. And correspondingly, there's going to be some cartographers who are sitting and writing down everything that the explorers are doing. At some point, the known world from one, say, country are going to meet the explorers from a different country, in which case they just, you know, sit down and have tea. They're done exploring. Or coffee. Okay, so we'll continue to do that, and then all of a sudden you start to see some shapes take place. And now we have a way to map the Earth, because the cartographers weren't just mapping out the shape, but they were also describing any kind of image, continents, and land that the explorers were encountering. Wow. So now we've got a way to draw a bunch of lines on the sphere. I'll specify it in one way or another. And lines on the plane. And I've got a computer which can do all the technical nitty-gritty details. I don't have to think about it. I just have to draw some lines. You can do that not just with the globe, but you can do it with spherical panoramas too. And so once I was able to do something like that, I'm like, wow, let's just play with it. And so I didn't create actually any globe for a long time, because I was having too much fun drawing different lines on the sphere and seeing what came out of the program. So yeah, it looked like art to me, you know? So let's jazz it up. Actually, I'm just kidding. This, I think, is garish. It's just a bunch of cheap tools, like a wet floor look and lens flare. But all gimmicks aside, I think they look, there's an opportunity for art here. OK, so let's start with some simple ones. A dot on the Earth is going to have all the imagery, all those explorers are emerging from one point, and that's going to be that azimuthal equidistant projection. And all I had to do was put a dot there. If I was to draw a line all the way around the Earth, I would get something like this. And that is simply the equirectangular projection, because all the explorers are coming at an equal rate from the equator out to the poles. If I was just to draw one line from the North Pole to the South, we start to get some interesting things happening. It's curved on some ends and square on the other. So we've got this nice capsule shape. Or if I was to put a dot on one pole and the other, we would have two hemispheres. Or in the case, when I say hemispheres and I'm talking about the Earth, I'm also using the above and below as terminology as well. The zenith and the nadir is what photographers like to call it. Okay, how about platonic solids? Okay, all I would have to do for that is to put a dot in the middle of each of those faces, and I would get nice unwrap panoramas. You might, this one right here might be familiar as the papercraft example I showed you earlier of Jupiter. But I like to do fancy things too. If this one was based on the tetrahedron, why not use a panorama of near the base of an actual sculpture tetrahedron? Why not? But those, the platonic solids aren't the only fancy polyhedra out there. This is more Greek. And the English language, if you look along the bottom, it just says the 60-sided figure. The 12-sided figure. The 24-sided figure. It's pretty simple, actually. There's nothing complicated. It just sounds complicated. And then deltoidal, that just means kite-shaped. Rhombic, oh, that's a diamond. So don't worry, don't be intimidated by these words. It's just a different way to say the same thing. But we can do the put dots or lines in this case and get some really fancy projections out of it. I really like the way this turned into some sort of Maltese cross kind of idea. All right, so the gores is what actually started me down this road. And the first thing I did was just draw a line from the one pole to the other for each little segment. And so that results in something like this. And of course, you can play with the way you want to arrange those segments on the plane to get different arrangements like this. And then, of course, it's great to cut out and very meticulously place with glue and whatnot to get one of these things. I mean it. It's not easy. And whoever can do it is I'm very appreciative. I've been trying for like 6 years. And this is the best I've done. So the gores. Instead of like 16 or 12 little strips, let's just do 3 or 4. Or maybe have the gores, not the lines, not go all the way from one pole to the other. And then you can do fancy things like that. Well, polyhedra isn't the only source of inspiration. We've got sports balls. The basketball is kind of interesting in that it's got kind of those gore sections. But some of those lines don't make it all the way to the other. And so I have to stop them early, and I would get a basketball-inspired projection by that scenario. This is a golf ball. Lots. I don't know if it's going to work out. I just tried it and saw. A soccer ball, we're going to have to, sorry, a football. We're going to have to do the inflate into a sphere kind of idea. So I'll do something like that. A baseball is pretty elegant. It's just got one line like this and the other line kind of like that. We saw the volleyball before. And a hockey puck, why not? A dot on the North Pole, a dot on the South Pole, and a line around the middle. Let's see what falls out. So we've got this. Okay, that's kind of neat. This hockey puck looks like a divide sign, which is great for MoMAT. I really like how elegant the shapes are for the baseball. And yep, this T is a classic way to form the sides of anything that's like a cube, and the volleyball is like a cube. Right here is, you know what, it's a bit of a mess. It's all the little dimples of a golf ball, and so the only way I can artistically spin it is that they look like the links of a golf course. But really, I was just having fun. I was seeing how crazy I could go. So, those sports balls were fine, but let's talk about those soccer balls. And here's the soccer balls that were used, the panel designs actually, for World Cup since the 70s. The 32 panel one, this and some more recent ones. So I did my best. Sometimes it's not exactly easy, but some work out better than others. And every 4 years, I have a nice soccer ball-inspired panel design to come out with. The thing I like about this one is how nice each of these propeller shapes nestle into one another. I bet you that'd be very efficient when you're manufacturing these things out of actual material. So I wonder things like that. Is that, were they planning on that? I don't know. Well, so one of the... I always like to see where I can go with this. And remember peeling those oranges. One of those common things to do is start at the top and go in a circle, spiral, down to the middle. Well, that's all I did with our lines is I did lots of little lines to make it look like a nice curve down the middle. And we got these things, which I think is awesome. This is the kind of thing when I saw it, I saw it first, not by me, and I'm like, I need to do that. And so I worked hard. Okay, instead of a spiral down the middle, what if we send out lines from the pole and go zigzag back and forth from the top to the bottom? Well, we get something like that. Okay, at this point, I've abandoned all pretense that I'm showing any sort of photo of something at all. But at this point, I was also very happy with the curves and the style that came out of something like this. Now, the one on the left there, I cut it out, and I got little bits of tape to take, and a little bit of patience. And what I found is that this forms a ball, a paper craft ball, and it's very round. And that's due to the way all the creases and whatnot spread throughout. So I did one instead of, we saw that one had four arms coming out. I did one with three. And I asked my friend at work, I showed it to him, and he said it looked like something. What does this remind anybody of? Call it out? I did hear frog's legs, right? So I thought, yeah, it does look like a frog's legs. So I thought this would make a great project for, this is a work in progress. It's the design for a woodcut, which is the medium that M.C. Escher worked in. And I hope to finish that someday. This is more of a winter project. But I thought I thought it was nice enough or a good enough state to show. Okay, so we were talking about that trick where on the soccer ball you took the edge and you replaced it with a wiggly line, just an S. In 2011, I believe, I encountered this thing in a paper by Kelly Delp and William Thurston. And they had the same kind of idea. They wanted to take paper and turn it into a sphere. And instead of straight lines, they just wanted to fill the space with the seam. They did it with, instead of an S curve, they really wiggled it a lot. And once I see a paper thing, I want to put imagery on it. So I created the corresponding kind of design with the lines and came up with that. And this took a little bit of patience, like two or three movies worth while I'm watching and listening at the same time. It was definitely fun to see it come together, though. All right, so I'm going to make a prediction now. The World Cup's soccer balls have had 32 panels for a while, and then more recently they switched to this panel design, which was 14 panels. And then they went to a 8-panel object, and then a 6-panel object. So I'm like, what's next? 4? Sure, why not? So what would the next World Cup soccer ball look like? I'm thinking, start with the tetrahedron, because we've got 4 panels, and we want to replace that edge. And instead of a wiggle back and forth, what if we spiral in one way, and then spiral out back to the point? We would get something that looks like that. Which I thought, wow, that's pretty neat. So I put it in. And I don't plan these things, how it's going to turn out. I just draw some lines on a ball, and out comes stuff like that. And so I thought that was pretty fancy. And I called it triskelion, because there's a symbol that, if you just ignore from this part on, a triskelion has 3 spirals. And you might see them on, say, the flag of Wales. So there's 4 triskelions there. That's kind of neat. I wonder if there'd be manufacturing problems, because it's very convex. But anyway, so why not cut it out and tape it together, and you get something like this. It's very round again. So it's possible that it could work as a sports ball. I just wanted a word on this particular panorama.
I took with my camera, and when I did remotely, it made a little chirping noise saying I took the photo, and it scared the heck out of that squirrel. You should have seen that go. There's a squirrel on there. And I just wanted to say that the way mathematics works is sometimes you're exploring something, and you have a feeling that you're just, you know, discovering new things here and blazing new trails there. But in 2007, Haresh Lalvani, which is he's an architect actually here in New York City, came up with designs for quite a number of sports balls, where he did exactly what I've been talking about, where you take the well-known polyhedra and change the straight edges into spirals and swirls and curves. So, and that's kind of the way mathematics goes, is it's there waiting to be discovered, and I think that's the joy I get. One last little discovery I made is after I made that little triskelion projection, I noticed that if I took it and made a copy of it and turned it upside down, that it would mesh very well with another copy of itself at two points. And that if I could continue to do that and tile the entire plane the way I'm kind of suggesting that you could do here. And I just love that about mathematics, is that it really feels like there's something out there ready to discover. And I hope I've been able to share with you some of those discoveries and that sense of excitement. And I want to thank you for your time.
I'm happy to say that we have a few minutes for questions. If anybody has something they'd like to ask Professor Swart, please just raise your hand high, wait for the microphone to come, and then you get a chance to hear what he has to say. All right, I see one right here.
My question is, what are the colors that you showed on the different spheres? The green and the blue, what do they represent? Like, is it just like like unique shapes that go into the sphere, or?
So the question was, I used lots of greens and blues, and what did they represent? As a software developer, I needed something to really show different colors of panels. So I could see green is different from blue. And the way I did that was I just iterated through a number of, not quite randomly picked pictures, but randomly picked colors. It's just a pretty choice. Their goal is just to delineate one panel to another. It's just pretty, that's all.
This is non-technical. I just wanted to know what typeface you used on your presentation.
That's Centaur. Centaur, Centaur. That's okay. I picked these things on purpose. It's it's really nice. I discovered it with a kid's book called Olivia. You might know that series.
Yeah, I was just wondering, when you're physically cutting things, how much are you just eyeballing it versus using a ruler, not measuring anything?
I've got a little, you can go to, for all this kind of materials, you can go to scrapbooking stores, and they've got everything you'd want from it. And the pros would use like X-Acto knives and stuff. I just bought a little scissors. The first few cuts are so precise and perfect. By the time I get to the end, I'm just slashing and hacking away. Hopefully this will be good, and all the bad stuff I just turned to the other side when I did that.
When you're taking some of these shapes, these spheres, and you're exploding them into these from these patterns, then you're flattening them, and now you're extending them. Have you ever taken some sets of these extensions and then tried to assemble them like, together?
If you mean literally, yes, I do cut them out and assemble them together. Is that
more than one? In other words, take three of.
Oh, like in this case here.
Three spheres,
yes.
If them, you're putting together.
Yeah.
And then
right.
Those.
So I've never done that physically. But let's think back to that flower projection. I did make sure the stuff lined up, and what you would actually get. This is just theoretical. I actually haven't ever done multiple copies. what you would get is different versions as layers on top of each other. It would be a neat experiment. They would all actually, because I've lined everything up, be part of the same sphere. You wouldn't have two spheres beside each other.
So something like that made
into something like this would have theoretical like problems where you'd have to pass the paper through itself. I don't think you could do it without experiencing some knotting problems, like you know, this needs to go over there, but it's underneath. Theoretically, if paper could pass through each other, it would all wrap up into multiple copies of one sphere.
So I've just been thinking about Google Maps a lot. And I was wondering if they use different kinds of projection based on the scale. So from space, you've got the sphere, but then up closer. Like, what kind of technology do they use?
Google Maps uses, I've been corrected and told it's not exactly the Mercator projection, but for all intents and purposes, it is. This is the Google Maps. Now, at some point, you're getting to Google Street View, which I think is a different product, but it's that view everywhere around you. I don't know exactly how they represent it on their side of things, but when they display it to you, as you zoom in or out, that's the rectilinear projection. That's the photo that man is taking or shining onto the floor.
I was just wondering how long you've been working on this project.
2006, I started kind of playing with the idea. In 2008, I made this program, and I've been playing with it since 2008.
All right, well, that many years of work, I think, deserves a hearty round of applause.